The day that this video is being released is January 21st, 2020, and it marks the 21st anniversary of the largest tornado outbreak in the history of the state of Arkansas. Today, I'd like to take some time to tell you guys about this outbreak, its place in the history of Arkansas, and the conditions that allowed it to develop. It's been a while since I updated, and I'm sure that's been very concerning for my, zero followers, and, five viewers, and that's counting me in the future, rewatching this. Hi, future Mapstro, get some sleep, we're really worried about you, man. January 21st is a day that I will never be able to forget. I was a little kid and the details are fuzzy, but the overall feeling of fear and awe will stay with me for the rest of my life. Over the course of that day, 56 tornadoes struck the state of Arkansas. To put that into perspective, on average, Arkansas sees about 38 tornadoes over the course of an entire year. In 1999, we well exceeded that number only midway through the first month of the year. As a whole, the state would record 107 tornadoes throughout all of 1999. Over half of them happened on that one night in January. The January 21st outbreak still holds several records. It's the largest tornado outbreak in Arkansas history, surpassing the 34 tornadoes that have been recorded on June 5th, 1916. The most tornadoes in a state on any day in January, previously held by Alabama and Tennessee, who had each recorded 13 tornadoes on January 10th, 1975 and January 24th, 1999, respectively. Most tornadoes on one day in January, beating the 39 tornadoes across nine states on January 10th, 1975. And most tornadoes in any state in the month of January, beating out Texas, who had recorded 25 tornadoes over the course of the entire month of January 1998. Taking into account the other states impacted by the tornado outbreak that started on the 21st and stretched into the 22nd and 23rd, there was over $90.5 million in damages, 9 deaths, and about 160 injuries. 8 of those deaths, 142 of those injuries, and over $12 million in property damage occurred in Arkansas alone. These storms produced around 127 tornadoes, with 56 of them happening on one day in Arkansas. The tornadoes in Arkansas tended to spin up along a line from the southwest through central Arkansas to the northeast, generally following Interstate 30 and U.S. Highway 67-167. Most of the information that I will be using comes courtesy of the Little Rock Weather Forecast Office of the National Weather Service. At the time of this outbreak, the Little Rock WFO covered 45 of Arkansas's 75 counties. During the January 21st, 1999 tornado outbreak, they tracked 30 tornadoes across 15 counties, issuing 48 tornado warnings, 80 severe thunderstorm warnings, and 22 flash flood warnings. 51 of the 75 counties in Arkansas had storm reports of some kind over the course of this outbreak. Other weather forecasting offices issuing warnings in Arkansas included Shreveport, Louisiana, Jackson, Mississippi, Memphis, Tennessee, and Tulsa, Oklahoma. In addition to tornadoes, these storms produced torrential downpours causing flash flooding and baseball to grapefruit-sized hailstones. The tornadoes of this outbreak were unlike those of most outbreaks as well. In a typical outbreak, the majority of the tornadoes will be on the lower end of tornado strength, which was at the time measured on the Fujita scale. Since 2007, the United States has measured tornado strength on the enhanced Fujita scale. Most tornadoes were F0 to F1. However, during the January 21st outbreak, half of the tornadoes in the Little Rock County warning area were rated F2 or higher. One of the largest contributing factors to the January 21st tornado outbreak isn't something in Arkansas. Instead, it happens thousands of miles away. 1999 was a year featuring La Niña, cooler than average waters along the equator in the Pacific Ocean off the coast of South America. This sets in place a weather pattern that creates a tendency for more tornadoes locally in Arkansas. Three of the top four tornado years, 1999, 2011, and 2008, in Arkansas have been during La Nina events. Several other factors contributed to this system being something of a perfect storm for a large tornado outbreak, but to understand how all that works, it'll help to go over a bit of tornado genesis, the pieces that must come together for a tornado to form. There are three critical ingredients in tornado genesis. The first one is backing low-level winds, usually coming from the southeast. The second is instability, called CAPE, which stands for Convective Available Potential Energy. This is a measure of the amount of energy available for convection, lift, and is directly related to the maximum potential vertical speed within an updraft. How fast can a storm breathe in? Higher values indicate greater potential for severe weather. Observed values in thunderstorms often exceed 1,000 joules per kilogram. So the higher values. And the third one is change in wind speed and direction. One of the types of change in wind speed and direction is known as bulk shear. Values of 30 to 40 knots can support supercell structures, but above 40 knots is more favorable. Generally, the higher the bulk shear values, the higher the tornado potential. Another aspect of changing wind speed and direction is known as storm relative helicity. Helicity is the potential for a moving fluid, like air, to follow a helix pattern. It's proportional to the strength of the flow of the fluid, the amount of vertical wind shear, and the amount of turning within the flow. This value is computed from the vertical wind profile of the lower part of the atmosphere and is measured relative to storm motion to give a storm relative helicity. Higher values, generally around 150 meters squared per second squared or greater, favor the development of mid-level rotation, which can sometimes form a structure called a mesocyclone. Basically, the gist of this is a higher value is generally considered to be more favorable for tornadoes. Now let's take a look at the conditions that were present over Arkansas on January 21st, 1999. I don't need historic weather data to tell you that January 21st, 1999 was unseasonably warm and humid. I remember that. That stayed with me. But I do have the data. Five locations in Arkansas set record highs that day. Another two tied their record high. There also wasn't much fluctuation in temperatures. 11 locations hit record high-low temperatures, and another two tied. For Little Rock, the average high temperature on January 21st is 51 degrees, and the average low is 31. On January 21st, 1999, the low was higher than the average high. The lowest the temperature got was 57 degrees. The high was 74. That high temperature was recorded at around 5 p.m., just about the time that the storms were reaching central Arkansas in full force. Temperatures in Little Rock had been 60 since before 2 a.m. and would remain over 60 until after midnight. Low-level winds that day were coming from the south, switching over to coming from the southeast. About 3 p.m., CAPE values in central Arkansas were reaching levels of about 2,400 joules per kilogram. At the same time, the jet stream was powering upper level winds at speeds of about 68 knots. Throughout the day on the 21st, the helicity was somewhere in the range of 300 to 500 meters squared per second squared. The atmosphere was primed for a tornado outbreak to occur. On January 21st, the Storm Prediction Center in Norman, Oklahoma, issued a rare high risk of severe weather across much of central and eastern Arkansas, as well as southwest Tennessee, northeast Louisiana, and north and west Mississippi. The risk warned of a potential for widespread severe weather, including several long-track and intense tornadoes. High risks are only issued a few times a year, if at all. The previous high-risk day had been on June 14, 1998, and another wouldn't be issued until March 8, 1999. The first tornado of the outbreak touched down at 3:10 p.m. in Lafayette County. The first causing injuries was in Faulkner County at 3:57 p.m. And the first causing death was in White County at 4:46 p.m. While South Arkansas did experience four weak tornadoes on the 22nd, the last tornado of the day on the 21st touched down in Craighead County at 10 p.m. For 7 continuous hours, tornado warnings were being issued in Arkansas. From about 3:30 until after 10 p.m., there was almost constantly a tornado on the ground somewhere in the state. So if the atmosphere was so ready for an outbreak, why did it take until 3 in the afternoon for one to happen? The cap. Cap, also known as a capping inversion, is a layer of relatively warm air aloft, usually several thousand feet above the ground, which suppresses or delays the development of thunderstorms. However, if the cap is removed or weakened, explosive thunderstorm development can occur. The cap is an important ingredient in most severe thunderstorm episodes, as it serves to separate the warm, moist air below from the cooler, drier air above. With the cap in place, air below it can continue to warm and moisten, or air above can continue to cool, either of which increases the potential instability. Without a cap, the air masses can mix more quickly or intermittently, which doesn't allow for a buildup of the maximum amount of instability. Think of it like a soda bottle. The cap is literally the cap. If there's no cap in place, and you shake up the bottle, it'll make a mess. But it wasn't an explosive volcano. However, if you keep that cap in place and you shake up the bottle, there's a totally different scenario at play. As long as the cap stays on the bottle of shaken up soda, everything's fine. Heck, if you keep the lid on long enough, it'll all settle down and it'll be okay to open later. However, if you shake the bottle as hard as you can, then immediately remove the cap, boom! Soda fizz explosion on everything. You didn't think I was really going to open it, did you? Even I'm not that dumb. But that's the same idea as a cap in severe weather. If it never exists, you'll have some storms, but they'll be gradual and less dramatic. If the cap stays in place the entire time, everything will eventually calm down. However, once the cap is off, severe storm development can start at full force. A cap was in place throughout the morning of January 21st, 1999. However, as those upper-level winds strengthened into the afternoon, the cap was broken, and all hell broke loose. One of the more prominent tornadoes was an F3 that impacted the city of Beebe, killing 2 people and wounding 29. The tornado spawned about 1 mile southwest of town and hit Beebe at around 7:30 p.m. Quick thinking and caution by school administrators potentially saved hundreds of lives in Beebe. A girls' high school basketball game was being played at Beebe High School that evening, with the boys' game scheduled to follow. School officials were aware of the potential for severe storms, and using a NOAA weather radio, by the way, if you don't have a NOAA weather radio and you live in the United States or Canada, you need to get one of these. They could save your life. Paid close attention to warnings issued by the National Weather Service. They made the decision to stop the game at halftime and send the 200 to 300 people in attendance home. 30 minutes after this decision, the gym was struck by the tornado with winds between 158 and 206 miles per hour. The gym was destroyed. In addition, the new junior high school was destroyed and there was damage to the BB Fire Department and to a church. The tornado followed Arkansas Highway 367 to McRae, where it took out the wall of the old fire station, destroyed the new fire station, overturned several mobile homes, and caused heavy damage to the post office. It dissipated about 1 mile northeast of McRae. The tornado was on the ground for a total of 11 minutes, with a track of damage covering 8 miles. Another famous tornado from this outbreak tracked from around Shannon Hills through Little Rock, striking the historic Quapaw Quarter. Several homes built at the turn of the 20th century were heavily damaged. At the Arkansas Governor's Mansion, a tree was felled, causing damage to a fence, and a treehouse that had been built for Chelsea Clinton was destroyed. Over 150 houses in Pulaski County were destroyed. A Harvest Food store was destroyed at 17th and Main, trapping 10 or 20 customers that had been inside the store when the tornado hit. Among other notable places damaged in the tornado was the home of civil rights leader Daisy Bates, the former fire station number 2 in MacArthur Park, the Arsenal Building, which was in the process of being prepared to become the MacArthur Museum of Arkansas Military History, and the Arkansas Art Center. The Art Center was actually hosting a reception that night for the opening of an exhibit. Many trees in MacArthur Park were felled by the tornado, and several landed on vehicles of those in attendance. 3 people were killed in the area, including the pharmacist who had been working in the Harvest Foods. White and Independence counties were especially hard hit during the outbreak, with 10 and 6 tornadoes respectively. 2 tornadoes, rated F2 and F3, had nearly parallel tracks and were separated by only a couple of miles in about 2 hours of time across northern White and southern Independence counties. They affected the communities of Holly Springs and Sunnydale, and areas just south of Pleasant Plains and Rosie, killing 1 person near Pleasant Plains. An F2 from Floyd to Center Hill wiped out several mobile homes and blew a house off its foundation. It caused 2 fatalities. At Joy, the volunteer fire station was damaged by an F2 tornado, and homes and businesses in Newark suffered mostly roof damage from an F2. It would take months or even years for many of these places to recover from this tornado outbreak. Homes, belongings, businesses, and worst of all, lives were lost on this evening in January. The physical scars are still present on the landscape of the state if you know where to look, and the mental and emotional scars will always be with those of us who lived through the night. However, this outbreak has served as a subject of research for meteorologists across the nation, who have used the information gathered to further our understanding of these horrific storms. It's also provided an opportunity to educate and inspire future generations of scientists. The Museum of Discovery, which had previously been in MacArthur Park until about 2 years before the tornado, has an exhibit focused on the Little Rock tornado of January 21st. The exhibit's called the Tornado Alley Theater, and it recreates the basement of a house in the Quapaw Quarter, and it uses firsthand accounts of the storm, archived television broadcasts, surround sound, special effects, to simulate the sounds and sensations of being in that tornado. It's definitely worth checking out if you find yourself looking for something to do in downtown Little Rock. Understandably, this has been a heavy topic in terms of subject and content, but I hope that you'll stick with this channel. Less depressing topics are coming soon. Thanks for watching. See ya.